No one believes in true patriotism more than the people in this room, myself included. But different people often see the same subject in different lights. And therefore, I hope it will not be considered disrespectful to those people by my presenting opinions opposite to theirs, freely and without reservation. This is no time for political correctness and niceties. The question before us concerns the callous and unwavering path of destruction our country is on. I consider it nothing less than a question of freedom or slavery. And as a consequence to the magnitude of the subject, there should be freedom of debate. It is only in this way that we can hope to arrive at the truth and fulfill the great responsibility to which we have to God and our country. If I hold my opinions through fear of offending, I would consider myself guilty of treason towards my country and an act of disloyalty towards the majesty of heaven, which I revere above all earthly kings. It is natural for people to indulge in the illusions of hope. People tend to shut their eyes against painful truths. Are we included in the masses of people who have eyes and do not see, and have ears yet cannot hear the things which will truly save us from our present path of moral, fiscal, and political destruction? Should that be the direction of wise men engaged in a struggle for liberty? For me, whatever anxiety, pain, or fear may cause, I am willing to know the whole truth and know the worst and then provide for it. I have only one lamp to guide my feet, and that is the lamp of experience. I know of no way of judging the future except by the past. And judging by the past, I wish to know what conduct the United States Congress, the President, and the Supreme Court for the last 60 years is there to justify the hopes of the American people that there has been a good faith effort to return to and obey the United States Constitution. Is it the insidious smile and ever-changing promises of politicians? Stop trusting these deceiving promises. We cannot allow ourselves to be betrayed by promises from these political leaders any longer. Their promises are nothing more than the kiss of Judas. Let's look at their reactions to our protest and ask ourselves a few questions. They have created swarms of militaristic federal agencies and policies such as Homeland Security, Patriot Act 1, Patriot Act 2, the Military Commissions Act, the NDAA, the never-ending assault on the Second Amendment designed to disarm the American people, the public notice given by President Obama that he has granted himself the authority to kill American citizens for the purpose of expediency rather than give them due process of law. Is this militaristic buildup necessary for a work of love and reconciliation or due process of law? Have we shown ourselves to be so unwilling to work with the federal government that force must be called in to win back our love and support? Let us not deceive ourselves. These domestic standing armies are the implements of war and subjugation, the last arguments to which dictators resort. I ask, what is the meaning of this domestic militaristic buildup if its purpose is not to force us into submission? Can we rationally assign any other possible motive for it? Does the United States have any domestic enemy so large to call for this massive militaristic accumulation? No, she has not. They are meant for us. They can be meant for no one else. They are created to bind and rivet upon us the chains which the United States government has been forging for the past 150 years. And what do we have to oppose them? Shall we try more public protests? Getting involved in political action committees? Voting? We've been trying these avenues decade after decade. We have held this subject up in every light that is capable, and remedy has proven to be in vain. Shall we try more desperate and more humble pleas? What path can we find which has not already been exhausted? Let us not deceive ourselves any longer. We have done everything that could be done inside their corrupted and usurped system. We have petitioned. We've remonstrated. We have supplicated. We have prostrated ourselves. Our petitions and demonstrations have been disregarded. We have been patronized and demonized. And in all this, most patriotic Americans cling to the fond hope of a peaceful return to state rights and a constitutionally limited federal government. What gives them this hope? There's no longer any room for hope. If we wish to be free, if we mean to live in a land of law where the constitutions of the states and the federal government are adhered to, and the federal government is truly limited, and we have true state rights, we must fight. I repeat it, we must fight and appeal to law, truth, and to the God of hosts is all that is left to us. They tell us we're weak, unable to cope with so formidable an adversary. But when will we be stronger? Will it be next week or next year? Will it be when we are totally disarmed and when government cameras are placed on every street corner? Shall we gather strength by bickering and inaction? Shall we acquire the means of effectual resistance by lying supinely on our backs and hugging the delusive phantom of hope until our enemies shall have bound us hand and foot? We are not weak if we make a proper use of the means which God has placed in our power. Hundreds of thousands of Americans, armed in the holy cause of liberty, under God with the true history of the criminal acts of the 36th through the 40th United States Congresses, are invincible by any force which our enemy can send against us. Besides, we shall not fight our battles alone. There is a just God who provides over the destiny of nations and who will rise up friends to fight our battles for us. The battle, sir, is not to the strong alone. It is to the vigilant, the active, the brave. Besides, if we are shameful enough to desire it, it is now too late to retire from the contest. There is no retreat, but in submission and slavery, our chains are forged. Their clanking may be heard in the halls of Congress, CBS, CNN, the New York Times, and MSNBC. It is in vain to minimize the matter. People may cry, peace, peace, but there is no peace. The war of subjugating lawful American states and their citizens is not something that might happen in the future. It is here now, and it is real. What benefit is there by standing idle? What is it that people wish? What do we want? Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death.